A lot of Cottonelle users have told us how much they like Cottonelle bathroom tissue. Now we'd like them to tell you.
I like it because it's soft. It reminds me of cotton. It's soft enough for my baby.
I like it very much. It's very soft and it feels a lot like cotton.
I just love it. When they say cotton soft, it really is.
Cottonelle. Of course it isn't cotton, but it is cottony soft.
Operation Venus is a toll-free hotline for young people seeking advice on venereal disease. Call 1-800-462-4966. KDKA TV2, Pittsburgh. Someplace special.
Good afternoon. This is the Marie Torre Show, the final edition of the Marie Torre Show. As perhaps most of you know, Marie is leaving us, going back to New York City for future horizons and another future, you might say. To us, it's rather a very sad day. We've gotten to know Marie. I perhaps have gotten to know Marie better than anyone else over the past 14 years. And I have to say, Marie, I really am sorry to see you go.
Oh, I'm so sorry to know that we won't be sitting together on that new set and the other times that you have been a guest on this show. Bill, you are a pro. You're all pro. And
he's wanted to tell me that before you will.
No, you know it.
We have a studio audience,
too. You really are. And it's been just a joy to work with you. Really, it has.
What are some of the things, Marie, you remember best about Pittsburgh?
The things I remember best about it? Well, I guess the first impressions. When I first came here, of course, there was a marked difference from some of the people in New York. I mean, the people that I didn't know too well, such as the saleswomen in department stores, taxi drivers. There was a marked difference, I noticed, when I came here, where in New York, you have to practically follow saleswomen around to get some help. When you get into a taxi, they think they're doing you a favor sometimes, that taking you to wherever you want to go. But here, I suddenly noticed in the taxi, the driver got out of his seat and he opened the door for me, which was unheard of in New York. The saleswoman actually came up to me and said, "May I help you?" And that was so nice to find. So that was real pleasant. Other than this, though, what I sensed about the people certainly has been borne out over the years here. The people are great. I just feel that they represent the greatest resource Pittsburgh has. Tremendous people. There's warmth. I've never had the feeling, Bill, that if I ever had any deep trouble, that I couldn't go to any number of people here who...
Don't look at me.
What did you say? Make sure you're left with six friends as pallbearers.
And if you get cremated, all you need is Radio Rich in a cigar box. That's right.
No, but it is true about the people of Pittsburgh, and,
Marie, when you came here into television, out of the newspaper business, what difference did you find when you first got into television?
What drove me crazy was the limited time. I found that I used to gather all this information about a subject and then find that I could only use maybe about 10% of it. Unlike a newspaper story, you can get all the facts and cram them all in, but you can't on TV, as you know, so that you just tell a very small part of the story in television, unless it's a very important story, in which case there's always a documentary or two or a special report on it. But as far as the body of the newscast is concerned, you really can't go into any depth on a story.
That's right.
This became difficult, trying to decide what to leave out. Very difficult thing. Also, the nervousness. Bill, you remember when I started, how terribly nervous I was, and I used to say to you...
When you started.
But I used to say, "Bill, how do you get over it?" And I have to say, you weren't much help. You said, "Well, yeah, there's no shortcut," and there certainly is no shortcut. You just do it.
Marie, do me a favor, would you? Would you repeat after me, Pitts?
Oh, I remember right. That, too.
Pronunciation of Pitts. Repeat after me, Pitts. Just say Pitts, all right?
Pitts, yeah.
I'll say Berg.
Berg.
And I'll say Pittsburgh.
Pittsburgh.
Oh, no. Did it again. We have a number of people in the audience here today for Marie's last show. We're going to introduce many of them later on, but first we'd like you to meet Marie's mother, Mrs. Rose Torre Grosso. Mrs.
Torre Grosso.
Torre Grosso. Mom. Would you stand up, please? Your mother's been living here in Pittsburgh, too, Marie.
She's been here a year and a half. Of course, she's very angry with me because here I brought her in from New York, and after a year and a half, getting her back over there.
Marie, there's some letters here I'd like to read. One is from the first one is from the White House. Dear Ms. Torre, it says. What's that mean, Ms.? You're either Ms.
You
or
haven't
Mrs.
changed it.
No.
Ms., yeah, okay.
Well, it says, I want you to know that my husband is running for president on the Republican ticket, and I... No, it says here, Dear Ms. Torre, I join your many friends in wishing you happiness in your move to New York. This last show on KDKA in Pittsburgh must be full of good memories, and your good times and good friends from these years will always be part of your life. The president and I hope that this day of goodbye is one of joy for a job well done, and that your move to New York City will bring you new challenges, new friends. Sincerely, Betty Ford, wife of the president.
Isn't that nice?
And here's another one, Marie. This one from the United Nations. Dear Marie, we salute a woman who has enriched our lives, who has disciplined herself that our tomorrows might be enriched, who through her work has sought to portray the confusing yet compelling spirit of today, who has made a name for herself, commanding respect, and to that, at least for us, we would also add affection. Best wishes for now and always. Most sincerely, it's signed Bill. From William Scranton, U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations. And here's a telegram, mailagram, I guess is correct. Dear Marie, sorry to hear you're leaving KDKA after 14 fine years. Wish you luck with your career in New York. Enjoyed working with you on topics of interest to Pennsylvanians. Noon in Pittsburgh will not see the same. Milton J. Schapp, our governor.
How nice. It's always nice to have those letters.
Marie, of all the persons that you've interviewed, whom would you say was the most outstanding or the best interview? I know that's a kind of a tough question.
That is. You know, I've had so many illustrations of, you know, real top people from, and you know, understand too that a good interview is not necessarily a good person.
Jack the Ripper would have been tremendous.
But I mean, in terms of color and those people who have provided me with good shows, I would have to certainly say Muhammad Ali. I would have to say Billy Graham was just tremendous on that, you know, person-to-person kind of interview. There's a gentleman who is one of my favorite people, and as far as interview subjects are concerned, this General Chappie James. He was the first black general in the Air Force. Just tremendous individual. He's about 6'6".
Yeah, I've seen him.
And he, he's just a great interview. I adore talking with him. But when I think of people who gave me good interviews, I certainly would have to list Jane Fonda. In fact, it was because of the show that I did with her and her husband. He wasn't her husband then. Tom Hayden. I won a national award. It was an excellent show, but there was a lot of tension. It was in the middle of all the Vietnam protests, and I have to say that whether you believe in her cause or not, she believes in it, and I think that because of her own belief and dedication to her beliefs, you just feel it. It just oozes out of her, and it makes for a very interesting subject.
Marie, what advice would you give to someone breaking into the business on how to do interviews?
How to do interviews? Okay, I've boiled it down to just a few salient points, really. One is to get comfortable in front of the camera. It's very important, as you know, to be comfortable, because if you're not comfortable, you're not yourself. Which comes to the second point, be yourself. I find, especially women, when it comes to being on camera, they react the same way they might in front of a mirror. There's an awful lot of phoniness. I mean, they pose, and I think this is a very distracting thing. I know it is to me. When I watch a woman on TV and she is aware of herself, I mean, the point that, you know, her mouth moves a certain way, and she just is false. Doing your homework is very important, knowing your subject very well. I find if you know your subject well, you don't even have to put down any notes to yourself. And the last thing is to listen. Boy, that's important.
That, I think, is the most important.
to listen, because sometimes the subject will come up with things that you never imagined about that person, in which case it's important for you to go ahead. Because when you talk to people who go around the country being interviewed, they come up with the funniest stories. I remember one man was on the Johnny Carson show one night, and he was telling how he was on one of these tours for a record or something, and he was being interviewed by disc jockeys, and he was telling the story about how in wartime he was captured by the Japanese, and it was a very dramatic story about how they physically grabbed him and they dragged him through the streets, and he says, and the people were exhorting his attackers on and stuff, and here he was, say, being pushed and dragged, and they pushed him up against a tree, he said, and he paused in his story for dramatic effect, whereupon the disc jockey, hearing this pause, said, "Do you have any hobbies?"
I've heard interviews.
But I mean, you get this kind of thing, you know.
I've heard that. Or someone will write the questions down.
And they'll stick to them no matter what the person says.
No matter what happens. We'll be back with more of the Marie Torre Show right after these messages.
For Marie could fry, Marie could bake, Marie had a way with a layer cake, and men for miles would race for a taste of her bouillabaisse.
Really an exciting election campaign. It's another fine example of a great American idea at work. And I urge every person to accept the responsibility of citizenship by voting for his or her favorite candidate on November 2nd. And I also urge you to be a part of another great American idea, building family security through thrift and home ownership. Vote for Great American Federal as the best place to save your money or to finance your new home. Great American Federal. Okay? Okay.
This week in TV Guide, Newton Minow takes another look at television. 15 years ago, as FCC chairman, he called TV a vast wasteland. Today, he thinks it's our most important educational institution. Find out what changed his mind and why in TV Guide.
I don't belong here. I'm a research analyst. But I can't find anything suitable in my field right now, so I work here part-time. It pays the rent.
We're developing a new product, so we'll need a research analyst to study the potential market. Did you ever try to find one?
If you're in the wrong job, call Job Service, the fast, modern employment service, bringing talented people and good jobs together. We'll help find the job that's right for you, no matter what you do or how much you earn, and there's never a fee. Call Job Service, or you may never find each other.
Excuse me, do you work here?
Yes, I do.
We're working to get people working.
Pennsylvania State Employment Service. We're in the classified phone directory under government.
We want to wipe out cancer in your lifetime. Give to the American Cancer Society.
We line up and wait in the street, Marie, for nothing could ever replace.
Continuing with the Marie Torre Show, we have some added guests who have arrived. I wish they would come in right now, Bill Currie and Al Julius, two of your colleagues in the newsroom.
You don't think I can come down?
I wondered. He showed up, of course, in the newsroom before and all dressed up. He's not usually this dressed up, as
he
you know.
He plays baseball at the House of David on the side.
And I said, what are you doing here? And he goes, he takes off on Friday mainly. He's, you know, it's the Jewish halt for the Jewish sundown. And
notice I got my anchor chain on.
I see that, yeah.
And he said that there was a meeting at 2:30 that he was.
I'm only sorry, Marie, that I'm not going to get a chance to cook on your show. You know I always want to do
we
that.
We did want this. He's a very good cook, Bill.
I want him to eat some of my cooking.
No, he.
The blandest. But, you know, Bill's gourmet food is Stouffer's. You know that. That's his high class.
Right, Bill?
That's right. But I'm only sorry I didn't come down to get a chance to cook. You know how I cook and. My
well, it was a matter, we were agreeable to, and you were agreeable, there was a matter of attire that we couldn't agree upon, what he should wear in the kitchen.
It was censorship.
It was censorship, yes. So we decided to scrap the whole idea. You don't cook at all, Bill, do you?
Certainly I cook, Maria.
Now he has to.
I eat. I have to cook. And of course, you never, I suppose, have ever been in a kitchen person with your financial resources.
Oh, come on. You've been in my house. You've tasted my goodies.
I've been over there and eaten, but I didn't figure you cooked it, because if I had your money, I wouldn't sully myself in the kitchen.
Well, I have my own idea of what home cooking's like, but I won't bring that up on there.
I think we've all had a shot at that. Well, Marie, I tell you, it's not going to be the same without you sitting that, you know, in the newsroom. Marie sits very close to me right at the end of the row, and your New York vernacular and the way you can express yourself, particularly in moments of stress and anger, have been very yes. instructive to me.
I don't want to interrupt you, Bill, but I understand we have a phone call coming in now. Wonder if we could take that telephone call.
Say hello, Bill.
Hello.
Hello there.
Hi.
Marie.
This is Marie.
This is Marty.
Marty, how are you? Hey, so good to hear from you.
Yes, what a sad day for Pittsburgh.
Oh, come on.
I mean it.
It's just figured as a new beginning.
Well, it's a new beginning, but a sad day for Pittsburgh.
Ah, you're very sweet.
Because of you, look what happened to the Steelers.
Are you calling from California?
I'm calling from Beverly Hills, California.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And I just wanted to tell you, darling, that wherever you go, you're going to help whatever city, you're going to bring some light into them.
That's so sweet. That's
because
so nice.
you're beautiful and you're intelligent. And you added so much to Pittsburgh. It's really something. Mm. And I want to tell you, why don't you come to Hollywood?
That's next.
You and I could do the sequel with The Last Tango in Paris.
What part will you play?
Huh? Well, the dirty old man.
That's very sweet of you, Marty. We miss you, you know.
Yes, and I want to tell you something, darling. The most important thing is that wherever you go, you know there are a lot of people who root for you and who love you.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm number one fan. Mm-hmm.
Listen, Marty?
Yes?
There's a number one fan of yours here, too, Bert Sokol.
Oh, yeah. I bought his album. Listen, it might be a good idea if he gave you 9 days at the Holiday House and I'll open the show for you.
What would I do?
Just walk out and be Marie Torre. You'll pack the joint.
Mm. Marty, thanks very, very much. You have certainly been one of the, among the warm memories that I have of Pittsburgh is the opportunity to get so much closer to you, seriously. You're a very unusual person. And,
well, darling, I sincerely have often, you know what I think. You know, I love you very much. It goes far beyond our professional lives, more into a very deep intimate.
Okay. That's lovely. Listen, I look forward to seeing you. Here, New York, California, wherever.
Well, you know, our friendship is a long time.
Yes.
And I'd love to see you.
Okay, you will. And
please,
thanks.
Come out here.
I will.
We'll work something out.
Okay. Thank you, Marty. I love you.
Yeah. Listen.
What?
I'd like to enter the Bill Burns lookalike contest.
I told him I have no answer.
Bill says he has no answer. He's just speechless.
Bill Burns has no answer? Never happened. Good luck, darling.
Thanks, Dan.
And I love you very much.
I love you.
Right. Bye-bye.
It was nice, wasn't it?
Very sweet.
Yeah.
You know, Marie, when you and I were doing the better half, Marty was always one of our funniest and
most enjoyable
guests.
Yeah.
Who do you think was, in all your experience on this program, in the news operation and on the better half, who is the most difficult person you ever encountered?
I think we've mentioned Pat Paulson was the top one.
I never.
You expected me to say something else? Oh, that we encountered. Oh yeah. Oh gosh. The he's from here.
Gorshin.
Frank Gorshin, yes.
You like him, don't you, Bill?
Love him.
You said some kind words about him up in the news.
Well, he said something about me, too.
Here is a case where the man is a fine talent.
He's excellent.
Frank Gorshin is a beautiful talent, but he is such a perfectionist and such a worrier that he never thinks he does a good enough job. And he gave us all kinds of problems because he wanted to do things over and over and over again, and we tried to explain to him that this is
one shot.
And you're, if it didn't come off fine, well.
Well, when you get up to New York, and if you get into a big television situation up there where you can create stars.
You want me to call you?
Yes. Well, you remember some of the poor people you've known here, like me and Al. Not Burns. He's not poor, but I mean the others.
Thanks.
That's true.
You've been unusually quiet, Bill.
I'm letting them do the talking. It's their turn.
She's always been an inspiration to me. I figure if she beat that Brooklyn accent, there's still a chance for me. You know?
She didn't beat it.
No, just a trace of it. You going to get it back again when you go back home?
I intend to. Mm-hmm.
The pipe will burst down at 33rd Street.
You going to say water again?
It's music to my ears. I used to love to walk into that end of the newsroom all the time and hear that New York accent just feel homey.
Who's going to spell it for you from now on?
Well, obviously Al can't
Not
spell,
me.
And Bill is never there when I'm right. I don't know who's going to spell. Marie is, for the benefit of those of you who don't know it, a walking dictionary. I can say, I never look anything up. I say, Marie, how do you spell it? And she
spells
it.
He doesn't even say it. He just says, nauseous. And I spell.
But that was today. I said, nauseous. And Marie doesn't. She knows what I want. She just spells it.
That's one of his favorite words. He uses that in almost all his commentaries.
Well, they are all kind of nauseous. Marie, I certainly hope you have outstanding good fortune. I know you will, because ability takes you wherever you want to go. And whatever you do up there, you know we're going to be following you with great interest and great good wishes for you. And my association, I felt like it in my little time in television that I was once finally associated with a sure enough star when I got on with you.
Sure enough star.
Sure enough star.
You've had all kinds of wonderful experiences in Pittsburgh, haven't
yes,
you?
Yes, I have. All of them instructed.
You'd never seen a World Series game until you came here?
Never seen a big league baseball game until I got here. Never seen a professional football
things
game.
Things that we taught you.
And I never seen a star.
Of course. All right. Okay.
We'll be back with more of the Marie Torre Show right after these messages.
For a girl today, it's clear to see, can learn if she studies the life of Marie, a lesson that isn't in books.
Giant Eagle presents Bet You Can't Pass This One Up coupons.
Just try me.
Okay, I'll bet you can't pass up a 4-pack of Northern Bathroom Tissue or a 5-pound bag of gold medal flour for just 49 cents.
49 cents? I can't pass that up.
How about 3 6.5-ounce cans of Food Club Chunk Light Tuna for only $1?
I can't pass that up either.
Fine, Bet You Can't Pass This One Up coupons in this week's newspaper. Good with any $10 purchase at Giant Eagle. Our prices bring you in, our quality brings you back, and that's the way it's always been.
You just can't pass them up.
Hi, honey. Look what I just brought home.
What is it today, dear?
2 Kit Kats.
2?
Yeah, 2 Kit Kat chocolate bars. 1 for me and 1 for you. But what? Outside, it's delicious chocolate. Inside, it's light and crispy and crunchy. Aren't you glad I brought you one?
Good, honey.
Chocolatey crispy Kit Kat.
Mr. Tony's fan, I really love your pizza.
Yeah, everybody loves Tony's. It's that gooey melted cheese, the special blend of spices in the rich tomato sauce, that golden crust. Tony's is so popular, I can hardly keep up with the demand. Well, I'm all done here, just 4 more stores and... Hey!
It's not easy being America's favorite frozen pizza.
Would you like a breakfast treat, Arthur?
I'd love a breakfast treat. Unfortunately, it's 10:43 at night.
Oh, come on, Arthur. Be daring.
Some people think because Teledoro calls these delicious goodies breakfast treats, you can only eat them at breakfast. But anything that tastes so delicious in the morning tastes just as good in the afternoon or evening. There is no wrong time for breakfast treats.
Well, in that case, I think I'll have one.
Take 2, Arthur. Live.
Teledoro breakfast treats. They're always good.
Oh,
In case you're joining us late, this is Marie Torre's final show on KDKA television. We have a number of Marie's friends in the audience. Also right up here with us, Al Julius, Bill Currie. And now we'd like to introduce none other than himself, Mayor Peter Flaherty.
Hi, Mayor. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Looks like you brought the Democratic Bible with you.
You're close. Actually, it's close to that. I didn't want Marie to go to New York without having some little keepsake from the people of Pittsburgh, and I'm sure it'll be.
Do I have to give the key back that I got?
No,
my
I didn't
here.
Bring you a key. My staff says, "What are you going to bring, Marie?" And I said, "Well, I could several things," and they suggested a key, and I said, "No, because." Actually, our doors ought to always be open to you, so thanks. You don't need a key to get back in the city of Pittsburgh.
That's
matter
sweet.
Of fact, what we have to try to do is get her back, even though you're going to New York.
Thanks a lot. That's great.
We'll be working on it.
Okay.
But what we did decide on is just a little... There's a great book on Pittsburgh, and I'm kind of biased and so forth, but I'm sure most of you have seen it. And it's got some great photos in there.
The Stephen Laurent book. That is beautiful.
Things in there. We want you to...
That is a beautiful book.
Put that on your coffee table in your plush Manhattan apartment and think of us once in a while.
Do you know there's a photograph of this show in this book, too?
I think so.
Isn't that nice?
There is.
This is terrific.
That's right.
So, thanks a million. That's terrific.
Well...
That's so good.
Somebody, I was listening to your show. They had me back in your office. There's flowers all over it, by the way. I don't know if you've seen it since you got on here. And there are other people waiting.
I'm going on to New York, not dying, you know?
And somebody said this is a sad day for Pittsburgh, you know, one of your callers. And I, you know, it kind of is, but actually I think we're overjoyed because you seem so joyous. You're moving ahead and you're doing what you want to do. And while we've had so many great years with you, why, it's kind of exciting, I think, too.
You're going to be doing this soon, too?
I don't know, Marie. I knew you'd get around to that. This is your day. This is the last
Put it to him like this.
Show.
How long are you going to stay in as mayor? Put it to him like, you know, gently.
There's How rumors, long are you going to stay in as mayor?
Well, there's rumors all around City Hall. Is he leaving or is he staying? Stranger things have happened. It's hard for me to leave Pittsburgh.
But it's your last time round, you said.
Yeah, I know I said it, but it's hard for me to leave Pittsburgh.
Well, what'd you say there, that you may reconsider not running or running again?
I don't know, Bill. A lot of, there's a lot of, you know, talk, will you stay, will you reconsider, and so forth. And
right now, Tom Forster, Gene Kuhn, and Jack Lynch just fainted.
Twist my arm.
Yeah, but Klein and Casey, they're very happy. You realize that. Does that mean you won't run for governor?
No, it just means that it's tough to leave Pittsburgh. I'm sure you went through this.
Oh, I'm still going through it.
Sure
I haven't left yet.
Sure, it's tough.
Yeah, it's a tough place, especially where you've made a number, as I have, you have made a number of good friendships.
Yes, and you know, it has a touch of everything you want in a big city, and still it's small enough that you can see friends and familiar faces, and you don't have to go very far, and there you run into somebody you know. It's a little bit of a small-town atmosphere here that I kind
of
It's
a little strange, but, you know, I was in New York yesterday, and it was so interesting. I had about three-quarters of an hour to spare, and I wandered in the Saks Fifth Avenue, which is my favorite store. And I was looking at something, and this woman came up and said, "You're Marie Torre!" And that's always just a thrill when you're out of town. And then I was...
It's none of your business.
I was on West 57th Street, and I felt someone running behind me. And it was a young man who said he was living here until last April. And he says, "You're Marie Torre, I know you, I saw you." But it's kind of nice that when you go to another city and you find people who do know you from your own place. Very pleasant.
You have the best of both worlds in New York. You can be anonymous wherever
true.
You live. And
That's
at the true. Same time, you can do your thing with television and radio and do what you want to do. That's kind of... That's one part of New York, I think, that's very good.
That is, you like that. Well, then, might you come to New York, then?
Last time I was there was for the convention. You know, I kind of like New York. I think it's got, it's come back a little bit.
Did you note that, Bill?
Al, it has. No, it has. We lived very close to Central Park when we were at the convention, and we went up and walked through there.
Through Central Park? yeah.
Did you get mugged?
Bad. No, I didn't get mugged. And it was a Sunday afternoon, so.
That doesn't make any difference in New York.
Surely, they're all in church.
They mug them at St. Pat's Cathedral.
But I think it's coming back to being from being on the floor like it was a year or two ago. I think New Yorkers are very conscious of the fact they want their city to survive. It's kind of nice to see that they're taking pride in saving their city. I liked it.
Mm. Oh, I'm glad you did. Maybe you'll come visit then.
Oh, I hope to get up there, and if I do, I'll be knocking at your door.
Fine.
Oh, it was nice of you, Mayor, that you could come down this afternoon. But he was.
Anytime I can get out of City Hall, Bill, I always take advantage of it.
I don't blame you much for that. I really don't. I'm not going to go any further now.
Well,
you might get into trouble, right?
That's
okay.
Right.
Ree, you reckon you'll get in jail again when you get to New York?
Yes. Why should I?
Well, why should you? You wrote a book and made a lot of money on it last time. I mean,
you know, Marie got more mileage out of those 10 days than the Birdman of Alcatraz or Johnny Cash.
That's right.
It really did.
Were you really in the slammer, Marie?
The slammer, you call it, huh?
Yeah, I mean, I know you had a controversy there.
Yeah, 10 days, yeah, sure. Does it make a difference to you?
No.
You're going to get up now, are you?
Got an FBI record?
Oh, yeah, 10 days.
I bet you ran the place. You probably had the warden's quarters or something like that.
No, hardly that. You know, in fact, just the other day, we were thinking about it. There were a number of reporters who tried to get in to see me while I was there, and the only one who got in was Mike Wallace. And he's trying to be the reporter. He went sniffing about, and it was true. They had painted this cell that I was in, and he said, "Is there fresh paint?" They had. Well, what am I going to do? They've painted it. And it was the worst thing they could have done because, do you know, it was dead winter. And do you know what happens when there's fresh paint and steam heat?
Oh,
it was just terrible. Oh, it was just awful. And then sometimes, too, if there are any bugs and things, it gets them out. And I went into the bathroom, and there I saw a nice big water bug on the shower. I never took a shower while I was there.
10 days.
You should have paid your fine.
Marie, in your honor, we'll be back in just a moment right after these messages.
Mariah blows the stars around and sends the clouds a-flying. Mariah makes the mountains sound like folks were up.
Son.
There's so much going on in the Sharp Carousel microwave oven. It's fascinating just to watch. After you watch it defrost, just push a button and watch it roast. The carousel turns the food automatically, so it cooks more evenly, more perfectly. No other microwave oven has it. Sharp's Carousel Microwave Oven. Next to it, any other microwave oven would be boring.
Hi.
Can we watch our chicken?
You can watch Sharp's Carousel at Kelly and Cohen.
There's a taste that's changing the taste of America. Diet Pepsi. Diet Pepsi.
Now people who turned away from the taste of diet soft drinks are turning to Diet Pepsi, the one-calorie diet cola with the honest-to-Pepsi taste. Diet Pepsi Cola.
There's a taste that's changing the taste of America. Diet Pepsi.
We're back to the Marie Torre Show, and Marie, we have another friend of yours here. He's just a recent comer to our city. We'd like to introduce Mr. Andre Previn, who's the conductor of the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra. I'm pronouncing Pittsburgh like you do.
Andre, hi. So good of you to come.
Well, now comes this thing.
Well,
which
everyone
I can never
is here.
Do.
You know what to do with it? That's terrible, Kelly. What? He's doing it wrong. He said, "No,
I'm doing it wrong."
No, he said, "It won't work that way."
Why don't I just hold it?
Hold it.
Like
it,
like an nightclub act.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
This is a little bit like This Is Your Life. It's kind of weird. Yes.
You've been listening to it.
I've been listening to it. Forgive me, I just came straight from rehearsal, so I should have got dressed for the occasion, but I couldn't.
I should know, too. You know, Andre says that in his wardrobe, all he has are either jeans or tuxedo, or black
tie. That's true. I haven't got anything, you know. Most people have kind of, you know, a gray suit, a blue suit, all that. With me, it's all or nothing. I either wear jeans or I've got on, you know, full dress. There's a funny thing in England, when it's a very formal kind of reception or whatever, they put on the invitation, decorations, please. You know, the first time, 10 years ago when I went there, we got one of those parties, and Mia, my wife, said, I can hang some Christmas things on you, but I think that's all we've got. So it is very odd. But no, I don't have any normal clothes.
Mm-hmm. Now, in England, do you find they're as informal?
Oh, yeah, really? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
As much as here now.
Oh,
well,
sure.
I guess this probably used to be more formal. Or it was one of the strongholds, well, the last holds, I should say, where you had formal attire.
Oh, but I mean, everybody seems extremely comfortable. You were always dressed very comfortably.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How about Bill?
You mustn't go.
How about Bill?
What about Bill?
How does he?
This
we
is
always
your program.
We say about Bill that he always looks as if he's going either to a funeral or a wedding.
And I'll tell you, there's not much difference.
No, it's very impressive. The white waistcoat and everything. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
He is impressive. He really is.
You're on television, look like you're on television.
That's what you always say.
That's what I always tell them upstairs, and they won't listen.
Well, how do you like Al Julius attire most time? Now, today he's dressed up.
I'm dressed like a slob almost the whole time. I just did this for you.
He's got his chain on. Look at that, Bill.
No, but I mean today, but at other days.
That he won't say anything. He sits next to me up there, you know. And
is there a watch on the end of the chain? Or
no, I'm going to get an anchor on one end and a microphone on the other. It's a very inside joke.
Did you meet Al Julius?
No, I
not officially.
So.
Andre Previn? Met Bill Currie?
Yes.
You've met the mayor?
Yes.
Of course you have.
Mm-hmm. Listen, I have an idea for you, you know, because all concert artists, or a lot of them, do kind of years of farewell tours and last appearances.
I was thinking,
you know,
of that.
Yeah, really, because in New York and London, anywhere, it's positively the last appearance everywhere. They have a big thing. You should do this kind of for months, and we can all come back every day, you know, and then eventually you just never go. I think that's a fine idea.
Sarah Bernhardt retired about 6 or 8 times. Why don't you do it?
Sinatra?
Right? Sinatra, yeah. And the price goes up every time.
But he decided to come back, I remember. He said he was going to retire. Mm-hmm. And wasn't it Florence Foster Jenkins?
Who's she?
Wasn't that such a person in the music field?
Well, Florence
she gave
Foster,
us tears.
That was different, because her debut was already her retirement.
But I know what you mean, because a number of my good friends have been giving me farewell parties, and I thought, my goodness, they're going to say, you know, hasn't she gone yet?
But that last free meal, Marie, don't go till you get them all.
Oh, and then you can start the whole return thing. Mm-hmm.
I know here at KDKA, they've invited some of all the people, of course, to have a drink with us later, and they was the first annual Peaches Memorial Farewell Party.
Sounds like it's going to happen every year, so.
Doesn't it, though? Mm-hmm. I intend to come back, of course, every year and say, hey, where's that party? Well, what else are you going to do while I'm gone?
Well, we probably shut the place down. That's what we've been thinking about, now that you're leaving.
You're all very quiet, you know.
Well, we came here to listen to you give a farewell address, like Washington's farewell address.
I don't believe in farewell addresses.
Well, we can just sit here quietly.
Do you have a forwarding address? Anything? No? No?
Marie, if you had it to do over, would you get back in the news?
Oh, yeah.
You would?
Yeah. Yeah, I would, even though I get a little annoyed with my beloved news sometimes.
Annoyed in what manner?
Well, I get annoyed. It doesn't apply so much to men as it does to women in the business. But there's still a tendency to cast women from the criteria, really, has to do with looks more than ability and news background.
Well, the same applies to men these days, doesn't it? Wouldn't you say?
Yeah, we're three prime examples of how looks have made it.
Yeah, we don't know. But I'm talking about the new field.
Oh, the new one's coming in.
Oh, that's the new field.
Oh, yes. Oh, certainly.
Well, you know, the other day I watched this this new girl on the Today Show, Jane Pauley. She was on an interview show, and it was just amazing to me how it was. We were at least 20 minutes into the interview, and not one word had been asked her about her news ability. It was all about when she goes to the hairdressers and where she buys her clothes, and just a light, frivolous kind of information, but it was as if there's no concern at all whether she had any ability as a news interviewer.
What do you think experience counts for these days, Marie? Experience in what you're doing.
Experience? Are you in television?
Television, yeah. Television news. What does it count?
I'd say no more than 50%. No more.
And the other 50 is what?
Has to do with appearance and...
So ability doesn't even come in then. Experience is 50% and looks is the other 50 and ability. If you hired fiddle players like that, you wouldn't have an orchestra, would you?
No, but it'd be nice to look at, wouldn't it?
You see, you don't have this concern with the newspaper field, as you know, Bill. You, TV, after all, is in the realm of showbiz, whether you like to believe it or not. You are, as long as you're doing your work before the public, and as large a public as you have, there is some concern as to the appearance. And I think, Bill, you know, you bear this out.
It's too late.
You
put them back on.
No, but you dress the part. You do. Now, maybe you'd dress this way even if you weren't on TV.
If I were laid out, I'd dress this way.
But anyway, there's another factor, you see, with TV that you don't have with the newspapers. You can be like a slob and sit behind a typewriter. No one sees you. It doesn't matter. The readers can't tell what you looked like when you were writing that column. But in TV, you are before the public.
Yeah, but I think that's changed all around, because even in my field, or even in the theater, I mean, when you read memoirs by people who were around, like the last generation, a rehearsal in a theater for a play or a rehearsal for a symphony, everybody came, you know, really, really dressed to the teeth, suits, shirts, ties, the whole thing. And that doesn't happen anywhere anymore. So it really is even behind closed doors when nobody's looking.
It's happening.
Yeah. I think if you have work to do, you should be comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't mean that. I'm not talking about the attire so much as I'm talking about the physical appearance of the person. In other words, if it came to a role in television, Andre, and you had to choose between a very mediocre-looking woman, say, mm-hmm. Whose background was tremendous as a news person, compared with, say, someone like who looks like a Jane Pauley, who was very attractive.
I haven't seen her, so I don't know.
Well, she's very attractive, but and say her background was
minimal,
very, very minimal. You would choose Jane Pauley.
You choose both, one for the office and one for the show.
But how would that one feel for the office when she knows she is really the tops in terms of, she knows news.
No, I meant the other way around.
Marie, you know, while we have the time, I think you should introduce some of your guests that you have here today. Mm. For instance, we see the head of the police academy, Jim Slusser, and his wife, Boots, who are here.
Mm-hmm. And
Mr. and Mrs. Aaron Levinson. Mr. Levinson's with Levinson Steel.
Yeah. And it's Dr. Garson, Warfield Garson, and his wife, Frances.
And Bert Sokol. Who was the manager of the Holiday House.
And Therese, who was his right hand.
Sikala, who was the right hand bower. And perhaps one of the funniest persons anywhere, Pittsburgh or anywhere, Don Brockett and his wife. Don, I wonder if you'd come up a moment. Maybe you have some bon mots.
How are we going to do?
First of all, I need his hand. Thank you. Please send in your contributions so I'll be able to laugh and play like all the other children.
You know what? You and I have something in common. We both have a leg. We both have one leg doesn't give a damn about the other.
And Bill Burton said if we ever walked up 6th Avenue together, the street would be clean for the first time ever. Fair offense, Your Highness. I was working for him in the rain the other day, right? In the north side. Hustling. I sold one voting machine. And I got $17 for it with the promise of Pete Flaherty to come to their house and teach him how to fix an election.
That's my commission.
That's a great garage sale.
How do you do?
Don Brockett,
Andre
Previn.
Yes, well.
Is that the great garage sale?
Yeah, I was over there. I sold one voting machine. I got $17. I tried to get 35 cents for him. I couldn't get it done.
Tried to sell me, Marie.
Yeah, I tried. Why? What happened in our lives, those of us who are in the theater and in the cabaret business, when Marie first came to Pittsburgh, it was an eventful thing for us because there was a funny time going on. It was some years ago, and it was hard to get people out to see you. So if you were a newcomer, it was hard to get the people to come out and see you. And Marie, being a professional newswoman that she is, instead of sitting around waiting to be invited, she anxiously accepted and came and covered us and really revolutionized an awful lot of my industry. And I'm not going to say anything else polite because I've told her that a lot of times. And I think that the best thing that she could do is go back to her hairdressing job she had in Brooklyn. Well, not too many people know this, but the only reason she was brought in for the news was to do his curls right before they went on.
Why did I
have you? She did Burns and Spit Curl for 3 years.
Why did I invite you up?
Do you remember that you do the routine with Barbara Carol Channing?
Right, yeah.
And when Carol Channing appeared here in Hello Dolly, she and her husband happened to catch Don and Barbara doing their routine in a review that I did of Hello Dolly. And they were kind of intrigued, so I invited them to see the performance. You were then at Kramer's, I believe,
right?
It was.
Yeah.
And it was just a lovely evening. After the show, after the Hello Dolly performance, she, Carol Channing, and her husband and about 6 or 8 other members of the cast went to Kramer's. And I'll never forget, we had asked them to provide some food at Kramer's for the company. And Carol Channing said not to bother about hers, and she usually took hers along, and it was bananas.
She was
peeling away bananas during the show. And she goes on these strange diets.
But that meant, you don't know ever maybe how what that night meant to us, because she was so taken that she bought out the room the next week and came back with the entire Hello Dolly company, 100 people, all the musicians, all the cast, and we were petrified. But it was a big thrill for us. Well, those are just some of the many things that you've done, not only for me, but for people like in my business, you know. But I don't want to get serious because, Jesus, I need you to get me on the air in New York. It's like Currie. I need a break. My God, Marie, I'm an old gypsy. I can't stand up much longer. You know, you got to get up there and do it for me.
Yes.
You know, right?
Right. That's what we're sending you off.
I'm
to pave the way for those of us who are poor and hired out and uncertain.
Well, I understand right now. Now, don't go away. I understand right now we have another telephone call. Hello?
Hello.
Hi.
You're on the air.
Hi, Marie.
Hi.
How you doing?
Fine.
What's this business about leaving Pittsburgh?
Oh, my. How are you, Governor?
Fine and dandy, Marie.
Yeah, I'm afraid it's true. I'm afraid it's true.
Well, you must have started as a child prodigy.
You're right, I did.
14 years. You're only 21 now.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Marie, we're going to miss you.
Well, I'm going to miss you, too.
I think that you've shown more sensitivity and graciousness on the air than anybody in the state.
That is so sweet of you to say. I really appreciate that.
Well, whatever you do, I wish you lots of luck, and I hope you find the type of work you want to do and are just as successful in making friends in New York as you have here in Pennsylvania.
I'm sure I will, but if I do it well, it's because I learned how here. Thanks a lot.
Marie, good luck to you.
Good luck to you.
We'll miss you.
And to Mrs. Schaap.
Bye-bye.
It was nice of the governor. He sent a telegram, made a phone call.
Yeah, it's worth everything.
Up for go the wage tax tomorrow.
I know it. Listen, can he book her in Harrisburg for 2 weeks? Or
who would want to go to Harrisburg? Why would anybody want to go to Harrisburg?
I don't know. Watch it. It's always flooding.
You've
got to be a great swimmer, I'll tell you.
There's a man. Now, right now, we're going to get on you on this. You're thinking of going to Harrisburg, but then you told us a few minutes ago that perhaps you might just stay here and run for mayor.
No, I've been to Harrisburg many times. It doesn't match Pittsburgh. There are many exciting things that go on there, but as a city, it doesn't match this city. Mm. Now, New York has some things that match.
I want Pete to be governor because I think he can give me some sort of executive clemency relative to this alibi
situation. Give him a pardon. you know, they have...
This is where you came in.
We're all right. We all want everybody to be successful so they can get us a break. I think
help me.
Did you know that Marie's going into that merchandising thing now? I thought that was a little shoddy. You know, the Marie Torre doll comes with its own little jail. She has the Bill Burns doll. It comes with a little curly black wig. And then this long wig and just change the outfit and it's Patty, you know. She's a Stuart Weather. What's that man? I was going to call him Stuart Sorokin, the poor thing. Bob Cosmodoll. You wind it up and it walks into the wall.
Very good. I like that.
Yeah, she's going into her little doll merchandising thing.
Where are you playing now, Don?
I am opening a new show. Oh, I thought you never had. So What Else Is Nude, which I'm not in because nobody wants to see my body, except a few surgeons. But So What Else Is Nude opens at Ben Gross's tonight, and then I go with Barbara to Jennerstown for the last 2 weeks of October to do Razzle Dazzle. I review. Thanks, Bill. God, I'm so glad. You know, we might as well all, you know, do a few. What all are you playing this week?
I guess it was a high
school. I'm due on in a few hours. Yes.
You're going to be spending about 4 months here, 3-4 months a year, huh?
Here? Mm-hmm. Yeah, 4 months anyway, surely. But it's broken up into segments. I can't really unpack permanently because I have to keep going back and forth to England. But it'll
That's
be nice
tough.
Next time. I'll be here for a nice long period of I keep hearing January and February are the prime months for climate here.
You'll love
it. Yes. Oh, yeah. Thanks very much. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, you don't have to shovel any snow, though, where you are.
Up on Mount Washington.
All you're going to do is a slide down, that's all. He's in Mount Washington.
Yes.
You can't get up, though. Not
that's
you
right.
Stand downtown.
He uses the incline.
That's the best way to get up there.
But, you do like Pittsburgh, though, don't you?
Yes, I love it. I think it's marvelous. People are more overtly friendly here than any big city I've ever been. It's absolutely true. You know, how many times you go to a big city and people either don't pay any attention to you or they kind of snarl at you as they kick you in the gutter. And people have been absolutely extraordinary here.
You get on to Point State Park some night, right?
Well, we cleaned that act up a little bit, Bill.
Hey, Marie, do you know what? A lot of people, too, are saying about, well, you're going to New York. Well, I expect to see you. I expect to see you on some kind of news thing. I won't be at all surprised to see you on a station here. I don't have any notion that I might not see you soon again. Yeah, I do believe that. I have that kind of faith in you. I won't be the least bit surprised to be watching a news show and see a report from you. I mean it.
Good.
You know, you just need me out there pitching for you. Oh, I can't get into that. I can't be an agent, but I do believe that.
We'll be holding out for the same $1 million that your colleague is getting.
Getting that here.
We'll be back with more of the Marie Torre Show right after these messages.
Give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square.
See the bright new thing today in pig.
Our prices are competitive and our sales are always exciting.
Our butchers bring you the finest meat they can.
So come on down and see.
We're the big red team at A&P.
Come on down to your A&P meat department and save on whole fresh fryers or box of chicken, your choice. Only 39 cents a pound.
Now, Planters peanut butter is better. Better than the leading peanut butter. And we proved it in a taste test. People preferred Planters because it spread better. And they loved its smooth taste. The fresh taste of Planters peanuts. No wonder people decided Planters is better. Serve it to your family and see why. Nutritious Planters peanut butter. Butter. Nothing pleases like Planters.
Hi, I'm Franco Harris. Off the field, I spend a lot of time with kids. As you can see, they keep me in shape. But there's something I like to do for them, to help them understand the importance of hard work. Whether it's reaching for goals that seem far away as a youngster, or pressing for the extra yard or two in a football game, there are no shortcuts. Of course, we all can use some help. That's why fatherless youngsters turn to big brothers and big sisters of Greater Pittsburgh. Why don't you make an effort to help a boy over the rough spots? Become a big brother. Call 621-6100.
I'm doing something I never thought I could do. I'm an Avon representative. Starting out, I thought, me? Run my own business? I'm too shy. Well, selling Avon has given me lots of confidence. I never felt so good. I'm earning money. I love that. And I make my own hours. So when my kids come home, I'm home.
You can do it, too. Become an Avon representative. Call area 412-355-0820 for more information.
Don't like goodbyes. Tears are
We're back to the Marie Torre Show, the final show for Marie as she leaves KDKA television after this program. And Marie, I believe you said you'd like to introduce some more of your friends.
Oh, there's some others, yes. So we, wow. Catch.
She should play outfield for the Pirates, right?
That's Patty DeMilio, who caught that cork, and beside her husband, Ed DeMilio, otherwise known as the Financialist. Kay Cushing, who is manager of the Pittsburgh Ballet Theater. John and Ann Hotek. You met this Levinson, Joan Apt, Lil Mancuso sitting in front of her, Paul Grossman, who is president of Cinemet Theaters, Rich Mancuso, who has a thriving business going. He cans tomato sauce, Italian tomato sauce. Oh, he hopes to one day. Very soakily met Therese, Bill Thunhurst, who is head of the Civic Light Opera. Aviva Radbord, who was a student of mine at Chatham and is doing very well as a news producer here. And of course, Leslie Brockett and Don. I think we covered everybody. Bill, you introduced the rest, my mother and sisters. Oh, Kay Ewing and Kirsten Ewing, her daughter, who've been very good friends, neighbors of mine. Linda Lands, all such good friends.
I think that's Currie has champagne here.
Champagne. What? Watch this. I might break the glass.
Pour it over yourself, William.
Yeah.
Is that all?
You got to try it. You know, I'm playing like I'm a waiter.
But don't send it back.
Give it to Marie.
No, he's going
to
taste it.
See if it's, you know, you don't give it to her. You test it to see, you know. I used to make my first wife.
What is this?
Swine food? Children taste the food before I'd eat it.
It's a vaccine, though.
This is swine flu vaccine.
New vaccine. That's right.
Is it all right?
Very good.
You're supposed to say if it's good now.
It's very good.
Okay.
I don't know much about champagne. I'm an iron man. Well, give me an iron.
I thought you weren't supposed to do, well, I guess.
We're supposed to do what?
Go ahead.
Do you
ahead.
Drink on TV?
You're leaving anyway.
It doesn't matter, but I don't know about you.
Not. As long as you're not plugging the I see. I think you're all right.
Everyone in the audience. Well, wait till the mayor gets his champagne.
There we go.
It's all right. I learned to drink out of a bottle. I can handle that.
Oh, here's one,
here's
Bill.
Here's Bill. And William, would you give a little toast to Marie?
I would be delighted.
All right.
Well, Marie, of course, we all are very sad to see you go, but very happy in the anticipation of what you're going to do in the future. May you live long, drink deep, and all your wishes be fulfilled.
Here, here.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Can I drink now?
Sure, yeah. Knock it back.
Everybody else is.
We should smash the glasses now symbolically, but they're plastic. Nothing's going
to
happen.
We're going to have a fireplace to throw them
that's
in.
Right, yes. 30 seconds. 30 seconds left. That's hardly time. Oh, my goodness.
That's all, Marie. Left. Running out of time.
Well, all I can say is just thanks, really. It's been so beautiful knowing you, appearing before you. I'm going back. I'm back to New York a lot richer, believe me. And I'm not speaking of money.
I guarantee
now.
It.
A lot richer in spirit than when I came here. So thank you very much. Bye.
Bye, Marie. Bye.
Bye, Bill.
Never get away from me. You can climb the top.
Marie Torre's wardrobe by Linton's. Set furnished by Kaufman's Pittsburgh. Flowers by Salvi and Tom.
True. But a little thing like that couldn't stop me now.
Sears Days is no ordinary sale. It's a sale as big as our whole store. Save over $76 on this Craftsman 78-piece mechanics tool set. Separately, the tools cost over $126. Now they're $49.99. Or pay $8.88 for a 3/8-inch drill or saber saw. And save $5 a gallon on Sears Best Weather Beater Exterior Latex. Now only $8.99. Sears Days is no ordinary sale. It's a sale as big as our whole store.
Previn Are you smiling at Emma Lou?
Emma, nothing. It's this chicken. That's seasoned with a crackling good crust.
Whose entry is this?
That's my new entry, don't you see? New County Fair recipe.
It is different.
Well, it's a different recipe with down-home seasoning and a country crust. Try some of it, won't you?
New County Fair recipe. Just ask for the chicken with the country crust at Kentucky Fried Chicken stores with this banner.
The Pennsylvania Department of Public Welfare wants your help. If you suspect a youngster under 18 is a victim of child abuse, call your county child welfare agency. Child abuse is everyone's problem. KDKA TV2, Pittsburgh. Someplace special.
And now, The Guiding Light. This portion is presented by Duncan Hines' new blueberry muffin mix with great blueberry taste. And by Sure, the antiperspirant spray that goes on dry and helps keep you dry.
Talk about stubborn. Every time my wife saw a Sure commercial, she felt like she was missing something. She even had living proof that Sure helps keep you dry. Me. But she still wouldn't part with her roll-on.
I like the control you get with a roll-on. Now Sure is available in a roll-on that is so effective, nothing will keep me drier. I don't always need all that protection, but when I do, there is a roll-on I can be sure of. New Sure roll-on.
Ready for the biz quiz? Okay. What would you add to your wash to get this permanent press clean? Bleach or biz? Good. Gravy-stained poly knit? Bleach or biz? Terrific. Ground-in dirt on white cotton? Biz actually whitens better. Right. Instead of liquid chlorine bleach, add biz. Biz is better on ground-in dirt and many kinds of stains, yet safe for all washable fabrics and colors. Biz does more than bleach.
Why, Hope, darling, come on in. Oh, my, aren't you a vision?